Your mic should be up.
I was going to say, well, the music's ending, so I can only assume that we're good to go.
Chris isn't here yet, but the show has started. So.
Hi. Well, I apparently Chris is our announcer at normal time. So, hi. Welcome to Opus Live. I'm Tracy. Welcome to everybody who's viewing online and everybody that's here at Vapor Central at 667 Yonge Street. Let me see. This is the only show, something that I have to remember to mention because it's the first thing that Opus always mentions. This is the only show where you can actually win weed. You can win weed. You actually have two opportunities to win weed. We will be playing here in studio a little later. And we play online with our friends from budbuddy.biz. So if you've got a smart device of any kind, get on vaporcentral.com and you will have two chances to win weed if you're in studio today.
There you go.
So let me see, this is episode 16. And this is my third one, sans Opus.
Totally Opus free.
Opus free. He is, our lovely host is in Nassara, Costa Rica, posting lots of pictures of food.
I heard he might Skype in, so it might not be totally.
Well, yeah, no. He misses us too much. I mean, I keep saying to him, like, he's supposed to be on vacation in Costa Rica. He keeps posting all these awesome photos, and I'm like, why are you on the internet?
I don't
understand why you're on the internet.
You're
on
in a
vacation.
Boat or doing something.
Yeah, but, you know, I'm hoping he's getting, like, you know, and then there's parts of me that I'm like, he's taunting me.
But, I mean, I think I would be the same. I mean, because for me to be on vacation, I want to enjoy myself, but watching Vapor Central live and being online and talking to you, that would be a part of my vacation.
Okay,
for sure.
No. Here's the thing, though. This is why I think he's taunting me, is when we were in Jamaica, we did a couple shows from Jamaica, and one of the things that I thought was missing was that there weren't any hammocks on the resort. Like, I was like, fuck, I'm on vacation. I need to go get stoned and lie in a hammock. And there were no hammocks. So then, we get back from Jamaica. Opus dumps me, leaves me with a show, takes off to Costa Rica, and what's the first picture he posts on Facebook? Opus in a hammock. He's taunting me. I think he sleeps in that thing.
I don't know.
He's taunting me, I swear to God. So I've put him on he's got a challenge. While he's in Costa Rica, he has to find me something very, very special.
Right.
So he's not just on vacation. I've put him on a quest.
That's cool.
Yep.
It'd be interesting to see what he finds.
It'll be good. It'll be good. Skype lines are open for those people that are online and want to call in. You should be able to call in for Vapor Central with questions or comments. I'm kind of going to get into some. You asked me this question earlier, so I'm kind of going to answer it for everybody. I've had some in the past few weeks. I've had some awesome letters from our online viewers who have been writing in to, you know, find out whether or not I'm okay and offering encouragement and stuff. Because this is welcome to the cyborg edition of Opus Live. Mm-hmm. I am in fact becoming a cyborg.
It's true.
So there's, like, you know, parts of me are all over the place. So it actually all started with Matt Murnaugh. For those of you who don't know, I am a medical marijuana user. I'm a diabetic. And one of those stories you guys always hear is that diabetics have to be really, really careful about their feet and not cutting their feet. Well, motherfucker, I cut my foot. Many months of antibiotics, and I think I've been on 7 now different antibiotics in the last 7 weeks. So when the big epidemic comes, I'm a dead woman. The World Health Organization said so. But the new round of antibiotics seem to be working. But it's been a little bit of a rough ride. I'm going to be honest. Normally, I am a complete control freak. I have to prepare for the show. My brain is Swiss fucking cheese. I can't really do much these days. I kind of pride myself on being a smart girl. I have been dumb as shit for the last few weeks, and I got 5 more weeks of this to go.
Oh, shit.
So this is actually kind of this is the story that I'm going to tell for the rest of my life because it proves I'm a tough bitch. So I started to get this issue. I went into the hospital for a little while. we thought I was on the mend and everything was going to be okay. We went to Jamaica. Everything was fine, except I got to Jamaica, and about 3 days in, I realized I was in fucking trouble. but we stayed in Jamaica, and we smoked a lot of weed, and I learned how to make honey oil with rum, and it was awesome. And got back and had to go back to see all the medical professionals again. And I ended up in the hospital seeing a doctor, and my foot was in pretty rough shape. And I didn't even really want to look at it because it was gross. And I don't, you know, we're calling it, you know, the zombie toe epidemic of 2014. It was pretty gross.
Gross.
And I can't look. So I have my arm over my head, and I can't look. And because I'm a diabetic, and one of the reasons that this all ran into a problem is, and I need to kind of make a correction here, because a lot of people hear this stuff, and it's people that diabetics whose blood sugars are out of control. My blood sugars are so in control, motherfucker. This was not a blood sugar issue. but I don't have a lot of sensation in my feet, so... He's like, you know, like, are you okay with what I'm doing? And I'm like, okay, I'm okay as long as I can't see what you're doing. And he's like, okay, cool, don't look at what I'm doing. And all of a sudden, all I heard was crunch. And my baby toe was gone. No freezing, no nothing, like a pair of fucking cigar cutters. And then I was home by 10:30 in the morning. I called my mom in the cab on the way home from the hospital. And she's like, how you doing? When are you going in for surgery? And I'm like, I think I just had it. And she's like, what? What, did they just do the surgery? And I'm like, well, I didn't see them do it, but I think I just heard them cut off my baby toe. And so and he did, in fact, cut off my baby toe. And I'm trying to find the bright side in this. I was in, for those of you who actually watch other online grow shows, Urban Grower, Opus and I, we were out dirt biking in Jamaica, and we are now the 710 Motorcycle Club of Negril, Jamaica.
Nice.
And I now have my biker name, Tracy Nine Toes, or Toes for short.
Nice.
So I've already been christened. I get my patch and my jacket next time we go back.
Yay.
But then I go back a couple of days later, and the doctor looks at my foot, and he's like, okay, it's looking better. And then he leaves me, and the nurse comes in to dress my foot. And for those of you that haven't had medical issues, it takes a certain amount of patience, and there's a reason we get upset at people. One of the reasons. So the nurse comes in, and the first thing she says, she looks at me and she goes, oh my God, that looks like that hurts. That looks painful. And I'm like, oh, it's, you know, it's not so great, whatever. Like, are you missing a toe? And I'm like, yeah, they cut it off here 2 days ago. It's like, I was here for that. Did you put it in a jar? And I'm like, well, I think so. They had to send it for testing. I was trying to get it for my friend. I'm trying to actually get the toe back so I can give it to Matt Murnau because he claimed any pieces that fell off me. So, and he hosts the Murnawana Zone on Tuesday nights here at Vapor Central as well. And then she proceeds to dress my foot and tell me about the summer that she was really depressed. And how she couldn't wear sandals that one summer when she lost a toenail. And I didn't punch her. And everybody says redheads have tempers, and I didn't punch her. So, you know, I think I deserve, like, there should be, like, if Pope John Paul and all those other pedophiles can become saints, I think I deserve
yes.
one, too. So then, now the other fun part is, like, now I'm talking about how I'm becoming a cyborg, so now we're talked about how they've removed a piece. And the mission that I have sent Opus on is that I want him to find me a crystal, a diamond, or emerald toe to replace it. So that is his job
nice.
In Costa Rica, is to find me bling.
He's going to be searching the caves yeah, for the emerald toe.
Yeah.
Snorkeling and scubaing, checking out caves.
Yeah.
Like, I got to look for this toe. I can't leave.
Well, and at first I wasn't sure about emerald because it was green. And that was kind of the problem in the first place.
Oh, that was just not...
I'm
gross.
Sorry, I have a sick sense of humor.
Gross, Tracy.
No. And so, and then I have this awesome thing. So I carry the little bag around. I'm attached to antibiotics as we speak.
For how long will you have that?
I have 6 weeks of this to go through. I've already done 6 weeks. So it'll be a total of 3 months I'll spend on antibiotics. fun stuff. But what's really neat is, okay, so they first did it with IV. And so if anybody's had an IV or an intravenous, they shove a needle in your vein and they feed everything through your vein.
IV?
Intravenous.
Oh, IV.
Yeah, so they into your vein. I've been a diabetic for 35 years, and I would make a horrible heroin addict. I have horrible veins. They don't work very well. So putting an IV in me was difficult, and the first round of antibiotics, it was really hard on my arms. So last Tuesday morning, I went into the hospital, and they gave me what's called a PICC line. And so what's kind of neat is that there is now a tube being fed from here. There's a tube being fed into my artery that's acting like a vein now. So that they just feed the drugs right into me. And so I have nurses that come to my house every day to take care of me, except I have to say, it's not like in the movies, Matt. The nurses do not dress like they do in those movies that you see on TV late at night. No, no. The male nurse, not really what I was expecting at all. I had really high hopes. I really did. And they don't really like the smell of weed in my apartment. So I kind of have to hide the smell of weed in my apartment. They're not fans.
That's not a good deal.
They're not fans. But it's not that big deal. I have to hide the smell of weed in my apartment for a whole 3 hours. Although everything in my apartment smells like weed.
I imagine. So,
so the day that I was baking was a little bit interesting. But I see you running around with a clipboard.
Yes, I do.
And I can only guess what you're doing, but would you like to tell our online viewers and everybody in Vapor Central what you're doing?
Sure, I would love to. Thanks, Tracy. As some of you may or may not know, there's a provincial election coming up. So that means that in the 112 ridings across Ontario, there's an opportunity to vote for somebody. And I personally run for the Freedom Party of Ontario in Pickering East, Pickering Scarborough East. And in order to get your name on the ballot, one of the things that they require you do is to go in the riding and get people to sign an election form. So here's Tracy Curley. He's another freedom
Look,
fighter and Freedom Party
surprise.
Candidate. There you go. And you know, this is anybody who does want to get involved. There are a lot of ridings left unfilled, and we're getting close to filling them all, but there's still a good, you know, I think 20 or 30 ridings that we have to fill out of the 112. So if any of you want to get involved, stop and talk to Chris Goodwin, the manager at the front, or Aaron Goodwin.
I think that one's working.
That's definitely not working.
Oh, Chris is here.
We can look up your postal code at the back bar, and then we can find out what riding you're in, and we have lots of forms here, so you can sign for the riding you live in, and it really helps get the candidate's name on the ballot.
Yes, that's right. Wherever you live, hopefully we have somebody that is running there, so if you stop at the front cashier and talk to them, they'll enter your postal code into a computer. We'll find out who our person is in that area, and you can fill out the form that will help that person get their name on the ballot here today.
Yeah.
And that's a big help. Like, you know, some people that are running can't get out and get their own signatures. So we go out and get them for them. Not being able to go out and do this doesn't mean that you can't run for a party.
So, particularly if you live in Don Valley West, I won't be walking lots of places to go get signatures. So if you could go see the folks up at the front desk, that'd be awesome. And here's something I gotta say, because, you know, most parents are often worried about peer pressure when it comes to drugs.
Yeah,
or
drugs,
cannabis,
alcohol,
marijuana,
lots of
anything like
things.
That. This is what parents should really be worried about, is that peer pressure will get you involved in politics. Because that's exactly what happened here, people. I succumbed to peer pressure.
But you've given 90 to 100,000 people the ability to vote for freedom.
Yes.
Which is a major, it's a major thing.
Yes.
And the issues stand for themselves. The people that are exposed to the meat and potatoes of the issues know that the Freedom Party has good policies. So.
And I've been able to sit and watch the birth of the Freedom Party.
Yes.
And its growth over the last couple of years. So
yes.
Proud to add my name.
And we're very happy that you're contributing.
So look, I was voluntold, and now I am. That's been my favorite new phrase, because it happens to me a lot. I am voluntold for a lot of things.
Voluntold. I like that phrase. I might use that.
Yeah. It happens to me often, You know, how'd you end up doing this, Tracy? Well, I was voluntold by so-and-so.
That's true.
And Matt Murnau, actually, who I believe is now running for Ward 20 and has taken his running out of the name for mayor, I think.
Yes, I believe he's I believe a city councilor. Chris and Aaron know, but somebody has stepped down. I think Matt is trying to step in as the Ward 20 city councilor. I think that's what it is.
It's, and I know his name too, and I just completely blanked.
Adam Vaughn?
Adam Vaughn, Ward 20, Trinity Spadina.
Stepped down after 15 years.
He's going to run for the Liberal Party in the federal election.
That's right.
Oh, I had to, actually, while I was sitting here, it was actually quite sad. I had a phone call. I've volunteered in the past for the NDPs.
Great.
And so the NDP called me today.
They've got your info.
They've got my info.
And
so they call and they ask me to volunteer. And can I give them money? And can I? And so they called me today and they're like, well, you know, are you interested? And I'm like, well, we got a problem. I've always been a supporter of the NDP because, you know, your end prohibition campaign and stance on cannabis. However, the Liberals have now trumped you.
Yes,
and they're
Justin
saying
Trudeau
and
Trump.
They're seeing legalization. So I kind of got to go with that.
Yeah.
And
I'm on the same boat as you.
You know, and you know, this is the one issue. And she's like, "Well, is that issue really important to you?" And I said, "Well, of course it is. I'm a medical marijuana user." And so for the last, you know, 10 years how they've treated 13 years how they've treated patients is ridiculous. And this is a way to solve it. So they're going to email me some information, but I made sure that they knew that, like, oh, I'm sorry, NDP, I have been
until
orange.
Until you put legalization on the table, you're a step behind the Liberals.
Yeah, and, you know, I have to believe that the Liberals are going to do it just based on financial motivations. You know, I look at, you know, their financial advisors have made a very large investment in a LP facility. So, you know, I'm guessing they're betting on legalization too.
Yeah.
Now speaking of LPs, what a clusterfuck that's turning out to be.
Oh God! And I'm not even—I don't know as much as you, and I already know it's a clusterfuck.
Well, in the last month, there have now been two recalls of product. Peace Naturals has had to do a recall of one of their products as of today.
Any further explanation? Or?
They're saying. Presence of bacteria outside of acceptable ranges of Health Canada standards.
Is that directly on the plants? Is that just in the facility? That
I believe it's on the product itself.
Actual product.
It's been recalled. Now, you know, so basically what this means is here comes our, you know, all of the companies that said that they weren't irradiating, because Tweed was one of the companies that said they would not irradiate their product, and now they've changed their stance on that. So now we're going to end up with a whole bunch of irradiated weed. Now, people that are... Here's the issue with that. It's what they're putting into the media about this and the problem with the mold or the bacteria and all these things they're now finding. Yes, some molds can be harmful and you need to be careful, but I did Matthew Murnau and I did the Zoomer TV. We did the Conrad Black Show Zoomer, and we were on the panel with Alan Young, lawyer Alan Young, who's fought most of the weed cases in Ontario. And we talked about the fact that, you know, when medical marijuana first came out on the forefront, you know, everybody took a big leap of faith, fear about mold and everything because of people with compromised immune systems, with people with HIV and AIDS. Mm-hmm. Like what we were going to do if somebody ended up dying from moldy weed or somebody got really ill from moldy weed, and it never happened. And you know, what if there was bacteria? And in 13 years, there hasn't been a case of, you know, now granted, you know, mold is not good for you and there are certain standards and you should certainly look out for it. But I think the standards that Health Canada is starting to hold everybody to, like part of the other thing is actually Mark Govedy, like this is actually funny that they actually have to do the recall because he was talking about how they were the new marijuana and how they'd identified this microscopic bug that left, you know, their microscopic feces
turds
on the plants, right? And it's like, well, wait a second. If you ever took fourth grade science, you know that we're all crawling with bugs being shit on right now. Because that's kind of, you know, don't think about it too much. And I'm sorry if you're smoking a really heavy sativa or for the first time and I've just put that idea in your head. But, you know, ain't nothing. You can use all the antibacterial fucking soap you want. Ain't nothing antibacterial. We all got stuff. This stuff is crawling all over the surface of everything. So if you know
and
you want to look for something,
we're sleeping,
you'll find it.
Those bugs, they hang over you and they can detect the CO2 in your breath. That's how they know where you are in a room. They fly over you and over you and they slip into your little CO2 stream and then they just fucking dive bomb, lay eggs in your fucking brain.
One of the things that I was talking to Opus about was that one of the things I am not jealous about, however, is that he did post a picture this morning about a visitor on his veranda.
Yes, a little tarantula or something?
And it was a giant motherfucking spider. He had the Bic lighter, and that was the spider. And I was like, don't bring that home.
You better take a decontamination shower.
Don't bring any spider eggs. Don't bring your luggage home. Like, no.
Cut all your hair. Oh, and he would never.
That just put the image. All right, for those of you who don't, that may be here for the first time, seeing the show for the first time, Opus has really long hair. And he actually posted pictures of jungle hair. I would not do well in Costa Rica. I would look like Carrot Top by now. It's true. It's just like
Carrot Top.
It would be wrong. And I mean, there's part of me that was jealous of Mick in Jamaica because he went and he got the whole cornrows done.
Yeah, yeah.
But I am not cornrow girl. Would not be a good look.
I wonder what it would look like.
This would not, no.
Be like Pippi Longstockings.
It would be like, have you ever seen, Carrot Top once had cornrows. I think Axl Rose once had cornrows. It was horrifying.
Awful.
I'm saying this, gingers should never, ever, ever, our scalps are too white. It's frightening.
The contrast is
it's frightening.
Alarming.
No, just, dreads? Okay. I've seen a couple like ginger dreads and I'm kind of like, okay, that's cool. Cornrows, no fucking way. No. It's like, yeah.
It's an interesting look for Opus.
Yeah, well, he had them taken out. But that was my favorite joke. It was awesome because I got to look at people and go like, I left with Opus and I came back with Bo Derek. And I was really trying to get like, it's too bad that I couldn't go into the water more when we were in Jamaica because I kept trying to get that shot of him coming out of the water and whipping the hair. Like, I just wanted that shot. I was going to put it on a Christmas card or something. Like, I was like, Opus's new business card. But, yeah, no, it didn't happen. Maybe next time.
So Opus will be back soon.
He'll be back soon. He's back just before the... he comes back... the night before, like the first night of the Champs Expo is business to business, so that'll be mostly retail. But he comes back the Friday of the Champs Expo. So I'm hoping we don't have a lot to do. I know we have some stuff to do. We're doing some stuff on the stage there at some point.
Yeah, that'll be fun.
But I'm actually really excited that the normal conference is happening at the Champs Expo as well. And
in the expo, or is it separate of the expo?
It's
on the stage.
It's on the stage. It's part of the expo. So I know Pot TV, Jeremiah, myself, Matt, we'll be doing some stuff on the stage during the expo. And while we're not on the stage, the normal conference will be going on as well. So they've got some folks from Normal USA that are coming in. Jillian Maxwell, who was our facilitator in Jamaica, who was an integral part of keeping Insight open, and an amazing facilitator. We wouldn't have gotten half the shit we got done in Jamaica done if it weren't for her. She's going to be there as well. They've got an excellent panel of kind of speakers, and I'm really kind of excited that Normal's actually doing a conference here in Canada. The presence has always been kind of sketchy, and over the last year, they've started to grow the Normal Canada brand a lot more.
Yeah.
And that makes me happy.
Me too.
I've always been a big supporter of Normal. Those of you that don't know who Normal is, and I shouldn't really say it, Normal, it's the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. So NORML. And you should support Normal. You should go to Normal Canada. It's $20. They have these awesome, if you've ever seen those I Am Canadian t-shirts, those are Normal. Go buy yourself a t-shirt. They also have really, they had them out this year. They did toques and they did the gloves that you could actually use your smartphone with.
Yeah,
that had the they actually did some smart, you know, kind of stuff. Canadians, you know, we need winter stuff if we're going to, just not just t-shirts. Let me see, so that's Champs Expo. Now, what I am kind of confused about with the whole Champs Expo, I know the Normal conference is going on, us folks from Pot TV will be there. But then there's the TY Cup, which I know is kind of happening at Vape on the Lake. Do you know anything more about that? Because I know that I have to go pick up passes for somebody on the Friday. And I am hoping that I will be walking without cane and actually wearing sensible shoes.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know exactly how the cup ties into all of it. Do you have any idea how that works?
I haven't heard probably any more than you have. I just know that Marco is going to be holding a cup, the TY Cup, and I believe he hopes that it would still continue to be synonymous with the Expo. I think that's right. Yeah.
Yep. Okay.
That's all I've heard.
Okay. So, I've been stuck at home. I haven't really been able to wear shoes. The only time I've come out for doctor's appointments and for you stoners. This is the only time I've left my house because I love you guys so much. You know, you guys rock. You know, I like to see my peeps at least once a week. So thank you for helping me not go stir crazy. All crazy, still there, but stir crazy, a little bit, you know, different.
Yeah.
So when I went in the hospital, like, okay, for those that know me, I have a serious thing for shoes. I kind of, this whole foot thing, I kind of did this to myself because not all the shoes I love are very sensible. I have kind of an illness. I have a lot of shoes. And so.
Is there a number, a ballpark?
There might be.
Are we like four digits?
There might be 90 pairs of shoes in my house right now.
Are they neatly lined up
and by color.
Because you are very meticulous in your...
By color and by glitter,
yes.
By stiletto size. It's all, it's all fabulous.
I picture it being perfect.
I'm not going to be able to wear many of them. The realization that, you know, I was going to have to buy ugly nurse's shoes. Right? I had to buy ugly nurse's shoes, lesbian shoes. I had to buy the shoes. And so I ordered them online. And because my foot isn't healed yet and it's still swollen, I still can't get the shoes on. But they arrived. And I've got big feet, which was part of the issue as well. And so these things arrived. And oh, my God, they were ugly. Oh, my God, they were the ugliest shoes I've ever seen in my life. And I have an awesome roommate and who has been taking care of me and doing all the shit around the house that I can't
do.
And
good roommates rule.
Yeah, no. She's been like the bomb, man. Like I went to Jamaica and like I left and 2 days later my Chihuahua went into her first heat. Like she's been dealing with me being sick. She took care of the dog.
Oh
like
my.
I owe this chick big time.
Yeah.
And then it's what she did to the shoes. So I actually brought them in. I was gonna wait until I could wear them. But I couldn't because they're that epic. So
let's take a look-see.
These are the shoes I'm hoping to be able to wear for Champs Expo.
Nice.
Like
those are crazy.
She fucking pimped out my shoes. They started as ugly nurse's shoes, and they are the stoniest shoes that ever lived. And so, when I can wear shoes, these are the first fucking ones I'm wearing.
Those are epic.
Yeah. So, my roommate rocks. And again, like I said, I've been kind of on the dumb. Like, I've been stupid. Then these are like, these are not fun, dumb drugs. Like, it's not like I'm like, whoo, I'm really high. It's like, fuck, I can't think. Why did I come into this room again? You know, and it's every 5 seconds because I apparently, like I said, making my brain Swiss cheese. So that I can't, there's a lot of things I can't do because of mobility issues. There's a lot of things I can't do because I just don't have the brain function. But instead of doing, and I haven't been able to bake because of standing at the stove, whatever else. So instead of doing a baking thing today, we're going to talk stoner crafts.
Nice.
Because, Maddie, I know, like me, you have a million weed t-shirts.
I do.
A million weed t-shirts.
I collect them.
And so do I. But the issue is that most of them are men's t-shirts because, you know, it's true, most of the stoner guys, there's more guys in this room than there are girls. It's true.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, ooh, it's rough to be me. what am I going to do with all these shirts that I've collected over a decade? So I started a craft of my own while I've been sick. And this is really easy to do. Guys, you don't even need a sewing machine.
This.
You don't even need a sewing machine because you can do this, and it's like, it's really easy. So basically, I took an album, if you guys actually even still remember, you know, the 12 by 12. I needed something that was 12 by 12. So I found an album cover, and I just took all my t-shirts, and I cut them out 12 by 12. And if you go online, you can learn how to do a running backstitch, and you can do that by hand. And so I have started the quilt of the many epic pot t-shirts that I have. And so it will take about 36 shirts to get to it. But I actually have those. And some of these are collector's items. Like, I don't know if you know what this one is. Buzzworthy's Cannabis Cafe. Okay. Buzzworthy is Eric Wood, and Buzzworthy's Cannabis Cafe was his basement. And you got one of these t-shirts, like basically if you have one of these t-shirts, you're one of the biggest stoners in the country. Because that means you did a bucket in Buzzworthy's basement.
Nice.
So yeah, Buzzworthy's Cannabis Cafe was, it meant you're a bucketeer. So this is my bucketeer shirt. I couldn't get rid of it. But I also couldn't wear it because it was like an extra large guy's shirt. So what the hell was I going to do with that?
This is old.
That is old. That is old.
I haven't seen that design yet, and I've been around for 5 years.
That one's one of mine from the old, old days. And I don't know if I actually have the front. There was the front of it. There were a lot of t-shirts that were done. If you want to hold that one up. This one says Compassion. There's actually 7 of these shirts. They're all a different color. They were for the Pride Parade.
Nice.
For Toronto Pride Parade. So there was Compassion, Legalization, Regulation, Education, Medication, and Pride. So 6, I think we did. And they were all different colors, so they'll all go on. And that was the back. Oh, yes. Okay, so the tattoo on Maddie's arm. All right. And I will fight somebody to the death for this because this right here. All right.
Tracy designed that.
Well, I came up with the idea. Somebody else actually did the design work and stuff like that. But I was working with the Global Marijuana March people and the Freedom, what became the Freedom
Festival.
Freedom Festival the next year. But I was working with the Global Marijuana March people and we were trying to come up with a logo. And we let the designer kind of do what he wanted to do, and he came back with something that was garbage. And I'm like, look, it's the Global Marijuana March of Toronto. I need a globe, I need a pot leaf, and I need the CN Tower. Like, that's what I need.
That's the
logo. And he left out the globe and just did the pot leaf and the CN Tower, and he came back with it. And I'm like, yep, that's it. Thank you. And it makes me happy. It was a cool idea, and I knew that it was an awesome idea because it was the Global Marijuana March, and it was there's some division in our community sometimes.
No.
And so it was the Global Marijuana March people that had this symbol, but then, you know, all of a sudden some businesses on Young Street and some businesses in the market had the exact same image all over their businesses. They'd kind of ripped it off, and I was like, people were like, trademark it. And I was like, no, like, I wouldn't trademark it because it's awesome, and I think it should be out there.
It should be shared.
And it makes me happy that you have that tattoo. So that's
That makes me happy.
So this is one of my proudest things, was that, you know, I was part of making that image. That's the global one. And then we've got lots of them. Like, so this is another Pride one, Compassion is Unstoppable. This is another Toronto Compassion Center one. I really liked this one because it didn't have a pot leaf on it. So it was one of those things that our patients could actually wear it to the grocery store, and people could say, what's a Compassion Center? And it would start the conversation,
which is great.
And then the Calm one, this was one of the first t-shirts I ever did. I was a big fan of doing t-shirts, making team-building people. And then there's other people's t-shirts. Like, look, there's one from the Vancouver Seed Bank from back in the day. That's an old one. And I have some really old ones that I haven't figured out how to cut yet. But they're very important. I actually have a Hash Mob tank top and an Up in Smoke tank top that were handmade by Chris back in the day. And they're not wearable anymore, and I haven't quite figured out how to cut them to get them into this quilt, but they're going in.
That'll be sweet.
Yeah, so this is like, so when you're trying to figure out, because like if you got a couple of them or whatever else, one of the other really cool things is you can actually go and you can buy album frames. They're the 12 by 12, and they frame t-shirts really, really well. But this is the other idea. If, like me, you have more than 36 pot t-shirts.
Yeah, that's such a nice way to recycle them and reuse them, and then it's like a sentimental piece of your house that you're able to reuse. And
yeah, and it's kind of something that, you know, it's kind of neat too. It's like, my grandmother left me quilts, you know.
I was going to say, my aunt made, like, my family made socks and stuff, and then my aunt has made a bunch of quilts out of all different sock patterns, and it's really nice. And I think I'm going to have to make myself a t-shirt quilt.
Yeah, and it's really easy. Like, I mean, like you said, you can do it by hand. The major parts, it's just a running back stitch. You just go on Google if you don't know how to sew. It's a really easy stitch. It's strong. And I've been, you know, sitting watching TV, sewing t-shirts together.
That's really neat.
That sounds like fun.
So I can't wait to see the finished product.
So yeah, we'll get there eventually, but I figured I'd show everybody what I was doing with my time and give you all ideas on what to do with your pot t-shirts. Because I've had a Rubbermaid bin full of them.
Are you randomly stitching them together, or have you planned it out how you want
to
look at it?
I'm kind of randomly stitching them together and kind of seeing what comes out. I'm trying not to put them all too close together.
Like the color, you're trying to separate colors.
Yeah, exactly. You know, make sure make sure the oranges don't go all in the same spot. But there's a lot of them over the years because you just collect
them.
They
all get misshapen and stuff.
And
so
you trade t-shirts with other businesses and other donors from other parts of the world. And so I've got ones from Australia. I've got ones from people that have gifted them to me over the years as well. So it's just kind of, and you don't want to throw them out because they're cool shirts.
Mm-hmm.
But again, like, you know, it's mostly guys in the industry. So you get a lot of guys' shirts, and it's like, I either have to cut it and re-sew it, or you wear it as a nightshirt, or it just sits in a pile, and you don't want to throw it out because it's a cool shirt. And I've done it with a couple of things, like the I Vote and I Toke shirt. I actually just cut the logo out of it, and I use double-sided tape, and I, you know, use it on the jean jacket or whatever else when we go out to protest or whatever else. That's my protest jacket.
That's neat.
And
I have a few shirts that I don't wear that I've been meaning to re-sew and re-stitch to repurpose.
Yeah, and it's just one of those things that it's really easy to do, and it'll save you space when you, like, I moved, so I was like, okay, that's it, I'm cutting the t-shirts. And I went through a Rubbermaid bin, and I cut them all down, and they went into a box, and now they're being made into a quilt.
So when did you start the project? How long?
2 days ago.
Okay.
So just kind of sitting in front of the TV, and because I have to be quiet and sit with my foot up. And so I cut them all out, and started sewing them together. And there are actually, there are a couple more panels, but I only brought two. So I am 18 t-shirts into a, so I'm halfway there about that. So then it'll make a, queen size duvet cover or quilt.
I might be able to donate a few.
Like I said, I've already got a couple, right? I need a Vapor Central one. I have my Kindred. I have a Kindred one. I have the Toronto Compassion Center one. I think I have a THC one. I have to make sure I do.
Well, I have an old Vapor Central one you can have for sure.
Here we go. Yeah, see, it's like
there's lots of t-shirts floating around.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Like, it's just, you know, that's how you, you know, it's the memories of. So, and like I said, it's one of those things that I'll be able to put away, and, you know, hopefully my nephews or somebody one day will go, hey, my aunt has this t-shirt about, like, the quilt of all these t-shirts when pot was still illegal.
You could even, cool. like, hang it on your wall as a wall hanging
yeah.
piece of art.
Yeah, and like I said, like, you know, for those of people that don't have the plethora, or it's like concert t-shirts too, right? The concert t-shirts, frame them. They have, you can get the 12 by 12 frames, and they actually frame t-shirts really, really nicely, and it's a really easy way. Or you can even do blocks of wood and nail them on and then just hang them on your wall, and it just turns, you know,
a nice
saves you space and actually turns, you know, decorates your house a little bit.
That's a nice decor tip.
Yeah. Well, so, you know, like I said, I can't bake anything, so I figured, all right, Crafty Stoner. We'll do Crafty Stoner this time. All right. So what else did I want to talk about? There's all kinds of shit going on in the news this day. And we have to give some weed away. So,
yes.
Yeah, look, they're ready for that. They're ready. All right, so who wants to win some weed? The first two people up here to the microphone are going to get a chance to play. How much does that bud weigh? Oh, look, there we go. We got our first two now. Making sure. You guys have never played before?
Yeah.
You've played before. Oh, you got to go back down. I need new players.
We need new people every
time.
We can't play twice.
Yeah, I want a new player.
You got to give everybody a chance to play.
I want to give everybody a chance to play. All right, look, now we got two. I'm sorry, man. He's mad at me now. I'm sorry. But go online. If you've got a smartphone, go online. You can still play online. Go to vaporcentral.com, and we'll be playing online later. All right, guys. So have you guys seen how this game is played before?
I have not.
Okay. So basically, this is you get to eyeball a bud of cannabis. You don't get to touch it. You only get to look at it. And you got to tell me how much does that bud weigh. You're going to write down your answers. And whoever is closest to the weight of that bud will win that bud. All right, so you ready? Understand how it works?
Yeah.
All right, so first of all, I need your names. What's your name?
Anthony.
All right, speak into the microphone, Anthony. I think it works.
Anthony.
Anthony, and what's your name?
Petter.
Patter?
No, Petter. It's like Peter, but better.
Petter. That's like Peter, but better. I like that. Okay, got it. Petter. Okay. So I need you to write down your names on this other side of this. All right, so they get to share a marker. And Matt, do you want to be the Vanna in this situation?
Sure, just tell me what to do.
You can be the Vanna in this situation. You get to hold up the bud. All right.
Just give them to you?
No. And then you're going to each quietly to yourselves write down how much you think that bud weighs. Now, what I will tell you about that bud.
Oh, did you write yours already?
No, just okay, my name.
What I will tell you about that bud is it is 100% African sativa by the name of Heisenberg.
Is there anything else you can tell me about it?
No.
Can you use it in a sentence?
No.
This Heisenberg really gets me baked.
You know, I'm high. How high? Heisenberg. That's I use. There's my sentence. That's how I'm using it.
Put it back on Bud Cam.
Oh, okay. Got to put it back on Bud Cam for our online viewers. Hold on.
But it is the bud I've been showing all night. So
it is the bud. That's why I made sure. I made sure that our online guys had a chance to take a look at that. So that is Heisenberg, 100% African sativa. It is I am a lucky, lucky girl that I get to have such beautiful cannabis. All right, so gentlemen.
It could be fluffy. You never know.
Sativa is known to be on the lighter side of
it. Well, and that's why it's called the eyeball test.
It doesn't look that fluffy, though. It looks pretty hard.
It kind of looks compact.
It's, aww. Yeah. It's crispy. Okay.
We'll see, I guess.
So, I've got Anthony's guess, and I've got Petter's guest. Petter.
Petter.
It's like Peter, but better.
Harry Potter.
Petter. I got Petter's guest. And I'm actually going to get the good old scale out here.
Okay.
And
so
I
what
actually
are their
already
guesses?
Know.
You might as well announce
them. The guesses are, I've got Petter's guest 3.7 grams. And Anthony has guessed 1.8.
Ooh, those are far apart.
Those are far apart.
Those
and
far
how's
apart.
Our, what's our online group
Chris,
saying?
Chris,
2.2, 2.4, 2.1, 2.9, 1.8, 1.5.
I'm going to come in at a 1.4 guess. I'm going to come in low.
Yeah,
all
well,
right,
you
can. Casey, the coffee guy is
here.
I
got to hold it.
You got to hold it.
I love having a coffee guy, and I love putting them all in suspense while I actually sit here and order my coffee
order
while
coffee?
They're waiting to find out how much this bud weighs.
When was this scale last calibrated?
This scale was last calibrated probably about 6 weeks ago.
You can just put a loony on it.
6 weeks ain't bad. All right, let's get that bud on the scale.
Whatever latte. Because Matt is going to be the Vanna of the situation. Is it zeroed out? And the weight of that bud is, drum roll please. Da-da-da-da.
We have a final scale weight of 1.9.
1.9. Our winner is Anthony.
What was his vote? 1.8?
1.8. But wait, Petter, who is like Peter, but better.
Petter, you get something.
All right.
You're going to win a consolation
now
prize.
Now eat responsibly. Eat responsibly. So enjoy the popcorn, or popcorn as I like to call caramel. There you go.
There you go.
And hold on a second,
oh,
Anthony.
Wow.
You are our winner. There you go.
All right, guys. Thanks for playing.
Thanks for playing. How much does that bud weigh?
What an awesome fucking game.
Yay.
Win free bud.
Yeah. I mean, and we'll be playing online a little bit later because our sponsors, budbuddy.biz, will actually send you marijuana in the mail. So you can go online and you can bid and figure out how much that
Phil Dabs on the chat room got it exactly, 1.9.
Nicely done.
Send us an email.
Good job, buddy.
Yeah, and
Vapercentral at Gmail. We'll send you a gift prize.
Yeah, we'll do the online version of that pretty soon. Coming up a little bit. Casey went to go get his coffee, which is awesome. And let me see. Where do you go? Yeah, so we were talking about, earlier we were talking about how Peace Naturals has now had one of their products recalled. We had Greenleaf Medicinals have one of their products recalled. And then I got to ask, I'm not exactly sure what's going on. They're saying a licensed grow in Mission, BC has burned down. But I don't know what licensed producer is actually listed out there. But apparently there's been a huge fire at a licensed facility in Mission, BC as well. So, wow. Let me see. There's been 2 RCMP busts, 2 recalls, and a major fire since the beginning of the MMPR. Way to go, guys!
Way to,
you know?
Way to set the bar high. Fuck.
You know? What the fuck? It's like... like, way... If you could fuck it up anymore. Like, we already knew that they weren't going to be ready
no.
for all the patients. Like, definitely. They weren't going to be ready for 40,000 paid people. There was
everybody
no way.
Knew.
Everybody knew they weren't going to be ready. But then just the clusterfucks keep coming. So now all these companies that have promised not to irradiate their weed are like, fuck, we have
I guess
to
we're
going to irradiate our weed.
Fucking idiots.
And, you know, it's okay that, you know, we put 9 million chemicals into a red lollipop and sell it to children. But apparently the microscopic bugs that appear on everything are now a danger to society. And like I said, like back in the early days when the compassion clubs and everything else, when they fought for medical marijuana, they were worried about the compromised immune systems, and it's never been an issue.
Never.
Again, because no one's ever died from pot.
No.
Ever.
And we won't.
And we won't. ever.
Anything, it'll be it extends our lives.
Okay, so this one is kind of fun for me because I live in Toronto, and I know our online viewers don't understand this, but in Toronto, your parking space will cost as much as my parents spent on their first house. And so, yeah, if you buy a parking space in Toronto, you're looking at about $40,000, $50,000.
Yep.
Which is what my parents spent on their first house.
You can get a nice two-bedroom, three-bedroom.
And then you still have to pay incredible insurance and parking and everything else. So I don't drive. I live in downtown Toronto, and the sacrifice I have to make is that I can't afford to drive. And so I take the TTC. And the TTC is $3 every time I take it, or $127 or something like that.
Something for a Metro Pass.
When I get a Metro Pass every month. Sometimes I get the Metro Pass. This month I didn't get a Metro Pass because, well, so far this is the third time I've left my house.
You're not going anywhere.
I'm not going anywhere. So it cost me $3. Apparently, Mr. Hudak.
You're not paying enough.
Is it? Didn't want to pay for the TTC when he brought a whole media team and everything
else. That was hilarious.
And then got stopped by the TTC officials and asked to leave the TTC property.
And good for him. He can't campaign on TTC property.
He hadn't paid the permit fees. And exactly, fuck him. Like, do you know, if you hop on a streetcar, this is the one thing that bugs me, is I've ridden the TTC, and I'm going to bitch out the TTC right now. I've gotten on the Queen streetcar and like had the driver like kind of stand there, and he's kind of holding the transfer out. So I grab it out of his hand and then gotten yelled at by the driver for grabbing the transfer out of his hand. And
I could just picture you the confrontational type on the streetcar, Tracy.
But the fact of the matter is that if I'm on the streetcar and one of their little streetcar cops comes on and I don't have that transfer, they're going to fine me $300. Watched them do it to people.
It sucks.
Right? And they don't tell tourists, and they don't tell people that, hey, if one of the TTC cops gets on here and you don't have a proof that you paid, they're going to charge you $300. And so I automatically grab one whether I need it or not, because I can't afford $300 for the TTC. I can barely afford the $3 some days. And if you want to film a commercial, if you want to, if you want to film a movie, if you want to do any sort of filming of any kind, if you want to busk in the TTC, you have to pay a fee, because guess what? The TTC ain't free, Mr. Hudak.
It's open for business.
You know, if you would like the TTC to be free, maybe the province should give more to the city. Just saying. Just saying. That would make things maybe a little bit easier. Although there's part of me, I gotta admit, I'm kind of jealous of him at the same time too. Because like the no pants subway ride, like all those prank things that happen.
Yeah, the fun things.
And and there have been a number of times where I've tried to figure out, like with photographers, because I did modeling in my past and stuff like that, where I'm like, I want to do a shoot on the TTC. Like, how can we get on the last car at midnight? Or how can we get in this station at that time and pull off a photo shoot without paying a permit fees and without getting arrested? You know, like.
Yep.
Because I know some people have pulled off some pretty awesome guerrilla photo shoots in the TTC.
Yeah.
And I know some people who've been busted.
Yeah, I've seen some good funny stuff from there. Hunter and Mike Rita, comedians here at Vapor Central, have done some pretty funny videos from TTC.
Yeah.
They're pretty funny.
But the TGC, like, you know, and you, but you watch YouTube videos and you see people that are doing like dance moves and doing like crumping and all kinds of stuff on like the New York subway and all of that. TGC doesn't have a sense of humor. I don't think the TGC has a sense of humor for
no,
that.
No, because nobody's happy to be on it, for one thing. Yeah. Everyone's resentful they don't have a car.
Well,
they're pissed off they're going to work or going home to their children who they hate.
Here's one of the things I don't understand. So I have a friend of mine who recently was on a plane and he was posting from his Facebook and he was flying first class because he's rich like that.
Was that Mark?
No, another friend. Okay. And he had internet on the plane.
Yeah, you can do that now.
I had Wi-Fi on the plane. And I'm like, wait, you have Wi-Fi on the plane? Why isn't there Wi-Fi on the TTC? Why isn't there Wi-Fi on the GO train?
Why, God help us, isn't
it? It would make people would, well, first of all, people wouldn't be happier, but people would probably be more polite because they'd be ignoring each other.
I think there's a quiet car now. Yeah, like, you can actually, like, if you don't want to hear anybody, there's a car where you're not allowed to make any noise.
Is it? Is there such a thing?
It's a quiet car.
Really?
On every GO train, there's a quiet car. Oh. And you're not supposed to make any noise. And if people make noise, it's like, there's more people that are not making noise than there are.
Then I have a question.
So they look at you and they, like, ostracize you.
I couldn't go to the GMM. I'm really sad because I couldn't go to GMM. But I kept seeing all these posts of people on Facebook that were, like, smoking joints on the GO train.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I bet you that didn't happen in the quiet car.
No.
Or maybe it didn't. That's why nobody knew.
We've had, like, one year we had, like, the visitors from Vancouver, the Pot TV crowd, I think Mel Hempseed and Jeremiah, they were on the GO train, and they were puffing, and I think they literally stopped the train on them and gave them trouble.
Yeah, like, I'm like, I've seen drunk people on the train, and I'm like, and they've stopped and, like, called the cops, and my train's been, like, 2 hours late, and I've been like, what the fuck? And I'm like, really? You made it to the GMM at 4:20 smoking weed on the GO train? Really? Like,
they might have done that, just taking the picture right before they got off and exaggerated. Or who knows what the entire story is. Sometimes you don't know.
Like, I'm almost, from now on, I'm like, I want video evidence. I want to be able to see it.
Right. I dab on the GO train quite a bit. And I take the GO train out to the East End where my family is.
Mm-hmm.
And I, you know, I do that quite often. And I'm always dabbing. And if it's a little busy, I just go in the washroom and do it. But generally, I could break out my unit and my torch, sitting in my seat, do a dab, blow the smoke downwards or wherever the fuck you blow it, who cares? And nobody's ever said anything. And I've had security walk by literally minutes after, and like I was sweating. I was feeling like,
now,
this is bad. But they didn't even look at me. They just were going to check something else out or whatever.
I don't dab solvent, so I don't... I'm a dry sift girl, or I'm an ice hash girl. I don't do anything that's done with solvents because I'm not a BHO. I became a medical user because I've already put enough chemicals in my body. I wanted to kind of minimize
reduce.
That.
Reduce.
I'm trying to keep it a little natural. Yay!
Just want to interrupt. We got Costa Rica on the line.
Oh, hey, well, hello the big guy. There.
Hey, how's it going today?
I was about to talk about one of our sponsors who I haven't really
there?
Seen much of. I'm still here. Where are you? Hello. Uh-oh. I can see him. He can't see us.
I hear you now.
All right. Well, then talk.
Hey. Well, it's another gorgeous day here in Costa Rica. I'm just, look, big dog. Hello, big dog. Check this guy out. But I'm having dinner at Pacific Azul.
Yeah, you keep posting pictures of food and the hammock, and you know I'm stuck at home cooking for myself or ordering from Just Eat, and you're sending pictures from a hammock.
You're tormenting her, Opus.
You're torturing me. However, today was the only day I was not jealous.
Yeah, you're breaking up.
You can keep that spider.
Yeah, the spider's gone. He left.
Good. Don't bring him home.
Yeah, I went out, and then next thing I know, he was gone. I don't know where he went, but I know he left.
Hopefully he didn't go in the house.
No. Never saw anything like that.
Yeah. How's the hair?
Outside of the cage.
Yeah, everybody wants to know what's going on with your hair. Is it cornrowed? Is it not cornrowed? No, it's
ponytail.
Out. I told them that you were having like jungle hair.
Yes, the cornrows had to be taken out. Couldn't get them redone here, and so it's jungle hair. It's just tied back crazy.
Gotcha.
Lots of fun here though. It was a busy day. Was playing in the surf. Had an hour massage. Had a nap.
Opus.
Yeah.
Fuck you. Just saying. I hate you. I don't really hate you.
But right
but
now.
You're making it really hard not to hate you.
Yeah. Well, I hear that the weather's gotten better in Toronto, so, you know, it shouldn't be that bad.
Well,
it's about to rain for a week, and there's no hammocks.
And I can't, this is the only time I've left my house besides doctor's appointments. Because I left, only time, the reason I came here is because I love you and I love these stoners. It's the only reason.
Well, thank you, Tracy. And we'll have to.
Now go find me an emerald toe, damn it.
I'm looking. And we'll see if we can't find you a. I think there might be a ruby toe somewhere here for you.
All right, ruby will work too. It'll go with the hair.
Yeah.
It'll work. Well, I was about to talk about one of our sponsors. We haven't really had them in, but they did help us out on a giveaway the one day, and I hope they'll be back. But I got to talk about it because you have one, and now through the generosity on our last show, Naomi actually gave me one of the Anubis pens.
Well, nice.
And like I said, I don't dab solvent extracts, the BHO, but I've been using this with water hash. And it's fantastic. Right. I love this thing, the Anubis vape pen. It's awesome. So
right.
I've been vaping with this. I took it to the hospital with me. It's awesome. And what I really like about it is, I've tried a lot of the different pens too, is things that are always difficult is you never know when they're working because you never know if they fire it up properly. You never know if they've heated up properly. With this, it's because you can actually see it, and then the light flashes when you're done, and then it's time to inhale. So it actually, you know, it's you can actually see what's going on. You know it's working. You know if it's broken. You know if it's empty. Really user-friendly. So I've been, I don't know if they can see really well, but I've been hitting the hell out of this shit. It's dirty already.
Yeah, I like the glass dome pens because for that fact that you can see that, you know, they are filling up with vapor, so time to hit them. I've been getting a lot of use of the mine here. Brought a little bit of BHO with me.
Wait.
Oh, yes, there it is. The globe.
There we go.
Like the globes.
Hold on. I want to get some of that. Now I'll fill it up. You can see how it works.
Oh, it looks like some of my dinner's coming here. My shrimp and avocado salad. Here, I'll show it to you.
Maddie? Oh, yeah. Look at that.
So, shrimp and avocado salad.
Yummy. It looks like you're eating really well. But you know what? I'm really noticing, like, because you're on vacation, how much people actually do post pictures of food. Like, I know what you've had to eat almost every day.
He's a foodie.
Well, I'll say this much. The food in Costa Rica is actually very simple fare. There's no real hot, spicy food here, surprisingly. Because it is sort of a Latin American fare, but it's very simple. But things are fresh and well prepared, and the food is excellent. I haven't had anything bad since I've gotten here. So I can say that, and of course, you know, in the tropics, fresh fruit, there's nothing like it.
Yeah, I'm jealous. Have you gone surfing yet?
I have. I was surfing the other day. I was out on a boogie board the other day. And the last few days, I've just been playing in the surf because the riptides are really crazy, and the surf has been really high and kind of crazy too. So it's kind of not been the greatest surfing weather, although the surf's really up. Lots of fun to play in.
Well, and I know that you were thinking about maybe going for your scuba certification too, but I don't know what that's all about.
It's a trip. But we'll save that for, I think, another trip back down to Jamaica, a better spot for that.
Oh, look at you, Mr. Travel.
Traveler.
Look at him. He's ready. He's ready to travel the world. Yeah.
Next winter,
he's gonna start doing the Canadian winter. You're gonna just skip the Canadian winter next year. You had enough of one Toronto winter, and he's done. Look at that.
Yeah, not even a whole one.
Yeah, because you got here in what? February?
January. End of January.
Yeah, so you didn't even put the full winter in. That's right.
That's why I'm here now. I had enough of that.
Well, no, it's finally started to warm up. Although I don't really care if it warms up until, like, it can be nice the champs weekend, and then it doesn't need to be nice again for a few more weeks because I'm not free until at least, like, the middle of June. So I don't care about the rest of you. I'm sorry.
Yeah, we got the Bong Man boat cruise at the end of the month.
When's that?
May 31st.
May 31st. Oh, shit.
Okay. I think there's about 10 tickets.
All right, I need.
Mine already.
Whoever's got an in, I need a ticket, cause.
And get ticket.
All right, and I guess and Opus needs a ticket, so apparently.
I need a ticket. I'll be back the Friday night of the Champs Expo.
Yes. Okay. So apparently, Opus and Tracy need tickets for the boat cruise. So, because as long as you don't throw me in the water, it's something I can do. So
nobody gets thrown in the water unless they want to get thrown in the water.
I will get someone to pick me up and take me to the boat and take me home as long as I can sit my ass down. Woohoo!
It's a great cruise. The food's great. The music's great. And of course, we dab it down.
I went last year.
Oh, did you go? Yes, that's
right. I did go last year.
I'll post a throwback photo this week, maybe.
Yep.
Guess who came to see me last night?
Who came to see you last night, Mr.
Ron Hill of the Toronto Cannabis Cup fame?
Cool.
He's doing his own boat cruise on the Saturday of Champs Weekend.
The Saturday of Champs
Weekend. So we also have tickets for that. If you want a $45 boat cruise ticket to...
Is that during the day or in the evening?
Hmm.
I think I'll be busy.
I think a lot of people will be busy, but...
I'll be busy.
Yeah, do you know the time on that?
I don't. But it's that
because the Saturday night, there's also the big party here the Saturday night.
Right, but only 200 people can get in here, and there's it's just I think it's a good idea that there are lots of events happening.
Oh, agreed. But you know, hard to choose. That's why I'm trying to figure out what all the times are. I mean, it's not like on a expo weekend I have not done 2, 3, 4, 9 events in one night. It's been known to happen. You know, it's just careful planning and sharing cabs back and forth to venues. That's just the way it works. It can be done. I always find that I like to end the night here, though.
Signing out, dudes.
Oh, okay. All right. I will make sure that we get you a ticket for the Bong Man boat cruise. And,
thank you very much.
So far, so good. I should be here next week. I'm all cyborged up now. And on the mend. So all you need to do is go find me an emerald toe, and I'll be back to its normal, rightful self.
All right. Well, I'll work on that.
Enjoy
you have a great
shrimp.
Show. Thanks. Good talking with you folks, and I'll see you in about, I think, 10 days.
All right. Enjoy your shrimp and avocado salad.
Later, buddy.
Later, guys. Bye now. See you, Matt.
Later, Opie.
I am jealous. I'm allowed to be jealous.
Yeah, I'm fucking jealous too. I've never been to anything like that. Like, I've never been to Jamaica. Like, you were in Jamaica not too long ago, so too much sympathy for you. I have sympathy.
It's true. And
I've never been.
Jamaica was a lot of fun, but I think what everybody kind of forgot is that everybody kept asking me how my vacation to Jamaica was.
It wasn't a vacation. It was like, work.
I was the coordinator on that. I had to work my ass because people I forgot. It's been a while since I've coordinated in a while, and what I should have done is at the beginning of it, explain to everybody that my new name was Princess or Goddess or something as epic. Because when you're doing that, people are always asking you for stuff. So by the end of the week, like, you're kind of sick of hearing your name because everybody's like, Tracy, where's this? Tracy, do you know? Tracy, can you?
Trace.
We normally, when I do events, like when I did the CanaMed Fair, I made all the staff at CanaMed Fair, if they had to come up and ask me anything or they had a question, they had to refer to me, oh, goddess, my goddess. Because I couldn't get upset with somebody who started out the conversation with, like, oh, goddess, my goddess.
No, that's a good one.
Right? How could you yell at people that start out like that? So, you know, I realize that on activism retreats, I now need to have to maybe instill that rule, is that I have to change my name, because by the end of it, I'm sick, like, Tracy, what? What? What God. Do you want?
Yep, I can understand.
Yeah, no, there's a little tricks that I have for running events. Like, I'll usually wear something really bright or ridiculous, because it's like, where do I find, you know, the girl that so-and-so? It's like, look for the girl in the big blue hat.
Yes.
Because they can find the girl in the big blue hat, and I don't
easy
have
to find.
And then I don't have to go back running and looking for the guy in the black t-shirt.
Exactly.
Because this guy was looking for you. Okay, where'd he go? I don't know. He was wearing a black t-shirt. Yeah, not the easiest people to find at all. Okay, so this is kind of the favorite story that I found in the news today. So the RCMP is pitching a tent at Wreck Beach.
Really? No, yeah. I've slept on Wreck Beach a few times with friends.
So those of you that don't know, Wreck Beach is a clothing optional or nude beach in Vancouver.
Right off the UBC campus.
Awesome. I have spent what is known as a sketch Sunday in Wreck Beach, most definitely, and begged my friends just to let me die and leave me here on the staircase. On the way back up.
It's long. Oh, God. Is it a long fucking staircase?
Oh, my God. You just, it's awesome getting there, getting back up. You never really want to leave Wreck Beach.
Take a few doobie breaks.
Yeah, you have to take
a
few.
You have to have a snack for halfway up and regain your strength.
A nap. Great place for a hammock. But apparently now the RCMP now from May 24th to Labor Day is going to pitch a permanent tent
and fuck with people
on Wreck Beach to fuck with people
so that nobody will sell
for public safety
fucking assholes.
And I'm like, all right, well then I believe that if that's what they're gonna do, then they have to be naked wearing only the hat and the stripes.
Yes, that's correct.
You know, like, I don't think that's fair.
Not fair at all.
Because like, any, if you've ever been to any of the nudist communities, everybody, you have to be naked, because if you're not naked, you're just the creepy guy.
You're the creepy guy who's not naked.
You're just the creepy guy who's not naked. You know, never be the creepy guy that's not naked. No one will like you.
No matter how bad you look naked,
no matter
don't
how
be the creepy guy who's not naked.
Just do it. Do it. You'll
do
fit
it and join
in. Trust
us. You know what? You'll enjoy it.
You know, everybody's usually so wrapped up in their own nakedness, they don't give a damn about yours.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, summer's here. There's lots of time for nakedness coming up.
You know, like myself.
Outdoor nude.
I'm like, is there sunscreen there? You know?
Yeah, you don't want to get,
you know, freckles. You know,
like,
girls got to worry. But I think it's crazy that they're actually going to put a tent on Wreck Beach.
That is crazy.
And the thing that gets me, too, is that, like, Wreck Beach has an awesome history in the stoner culture, too, right? I don't know if you know the story of Watermelon, Weed Diva Watermelon. Do you know Watermelon at all, Mr. Oliver, Matt? Do you know who she is? Watermelon Weed Diva from Vancouver, BC. You do know who she is?
Pardon?
Do you know who Watermelon Weed Diva is?
Oh, of course, yes,
okay.
Yes. The Watermelon Defense.
The Watermelon Defense. If you can eat it, you can beat it.
Yeah, that's right.
And she was... One of the fundraisers I have always wanted to do is I so want a copy of that woman's mugshot. She was arrested on Wreck Beach.
Nude.
topless.
Okay, topless.
I don't think, I don't think she was completely nude, but she was at least topless. She was arrested on Wreck Beach selling pot cookies. Allegedly selling pot cookies. And they sent like a hovercraft and the SWAT team for that naked girl selling cookies. Like she's selling ginger snaps for Christ's sakes. And the reason she has the name Watermelon is she also used to sell slices of watermelon on the beach as well. So what, rather than plead guilty and do all the things that most people would do, Watermelon fought the charges and she proved, hey, if you can eat it, you can beat it. Because what the fuck are they going to do? Charge her with 3 pounds of cookies? Right? You know, it was trying to prove the content. They have figured out ways since then to kind of prove content. But back then, you know, it was a tough charge to prove. And she fought all her charges and she won. So I'm kind of disgusted with the fact that RCMP's taken over Wreck Beach now. Because I'm like, no, man. You guys came in, you came after Watermelon, and mm-hmm. she kicked your ass.
Now you're just going to set up shop.
Stay
right
off
on the beach.
Our turf.
You lost. You know? You're not welcome
yeah,
here.
Like,
fuck
yeah.
Off.
And, you know, it's just like it's just a buzzkill. Nobody, like, nobody wants to do yoga while the RCMP is watching. Like, it just, you know, it just, it kind of fucks with your zen.
Yeah.
I don't want to do anything while the RCMP is watching. Thank you very much. Hi, RCMP.
Fuck up.
Thanks for watching.
Smoking all the weed they fucking confiscated.
Yeah. And that's, yeah, often that is exactly what happens. And they're like, oh, well, it dried out. I'm like, yeah, in 3 days. Mm-hmm. Wow, that's amazing. All right, kind of one of those other things that kind of is kind of crazy. So I'm kind of, and this is, I'm glad you're here, Maddie, because I'm going to make you discuss a very difficult topic.
I might have to go soon. I got to get more signatures before the light leaves us.
You will be.
How long? When time is the show over?
I got about, I don't know. I think I got about half an hour left.
Okay.
20 minutes, half an hour left, something like that.
What do you got?
Chris will be able to tell you. Well, I don't know if you saw that, but heard it, but Justin Trudeau has basically come out and said that the pro-life people need not come forward looking for a nomination in the Liberal Party. That if you're a pro-life person, that you're not welcome. That, you know, it's pro-choice or nothing kind of deal.
Right.
And I actually find that kind of, like, that's a bold statement, right? Like, I get it. Like, but I actually, and I read an article that I wasn't sure how I was going to take. It was like, basically, you say you're pro-choice, but when you say that the pro-life people can't participate, you're saying that pro-life isn't a choice. and I don't necessarily agree with that statement, but I understand the sentiment behind it. That, you know, if you're excluding those groups of people, then you're saying that, you know, being pro-life isn't an actual, that you're not actually pro-choice. But I'm actually kind of interested in what Justin's saying these days, because I mean those are two really bold statements that he's now made. It's like, you know, hey, I am pro-choice, and hey, legalization. Those are two pretty big topics, and I'm kind of waiting. I'm like, come on, say something about prostitution. Come on, do it,
yeah.
Do it. I dare ya. you know, like make it a trifecta.
Yeah, that's it.
And I mean, the reason that I find this interesting is I come from one of the only provinces where now technically this statement is false, but technically it's right. I come from the only province in this country where abortion is still illegal. Prince Edward Island, they do not perform abortions. So you have to, if you're a 14-year-old girl who got pregnant, you have to figure out a way to get off province, which costs $50 because you have to actually pay to get off of Prince Edward Island because there's the ferry ride. And then you have to explain to your parents while you're going to New Brunswick, you're going to the mainland for a couple of days. So there are still a lot of 14-year-old girls that are throwing themselves down the stairs and trying to drink bleach. Because they're too scared to tell their parents that they're pregnant. And there are a lot of girls that are really young that have had kids. And
that's awful.
And I've always said it. It's and I love my home province. They're the coolest people, and I come from they're awesome. But wake the fuck up, and so I always find this is an interesting thing. Like, you know, here at Prince Edward Island, they've approved licensed producers. Like, they're supporting the farmers. Hey, come grow weed. The soil farms. Yeah, okay. And I mean, again, Prince Edward Island, I mean, both of my great grandfathers were rum runners. I mean, that province survived during Prohibition. That province thrived during Prohibition. But they're like, okay, yeah, bring on the weed. But when the whole idea of actually putting a abortion clinic or a clinic of any kind in Prince Edward Island came up, people freaked the fuck out. And it was a really big deal. They even put a Planned Parenthood in PEI, and they're still fighting for it. And I mean, most people, I mean, it is a choice, because everybody makes their own personal choice whenever it comes out, and I say that as a woman. But the fact of the matter is that, you know, you have to give people a choice. Saying that, oh, the province will pay for it, but we just won't do it here, doesn't actually make it accessible for people.
Nope.
And it doesn't make it accessible for the people that need it the most, which are the people that, you know, end up falling through the cracks in the system and stuff like that. So there's parts of me that want to applaud Trudeau for saying, like, look, if you don't believe that women have a choice, you don't have a place here. But there's also that part of me too that kind of gets what they're saying. It's like, well, wait a second, you say you're pro-choice. So isn't life being pro-life a choice? You know, there's that paradigm there that's kind of interesting that I find different. But and I like the fact that I think that's kind of the message we've been trying to get out for a lot of people. So I'm reminding the people in the crowd here, your job is to vote. If you're a stoner, please vote. Please motherfucking vote.
There's a number of Freedom Party candidates that are going to be running in the upcoming provincial election. I'm running in Scarborough East.
Yep.
Chris is running downtown. Aaron's running in Thornhill.
There are options.
We are a party that is a little bit different than all the other ones. We don't say the same shit.
But when we come down to the federal election, let's be honest. We need to vote liberal. There needs to be a unity in the vote. The liberals are calling for legalization. This is the only shot we've had. And I am loath to tell people how to vote. I was not raised that way. We did not discuss our votes in my family. We did not discuss politics. That was a personal choice. It was a big deal when I first went to vote when I was 18. It was a very, very big deal. And so for me to tell all you people to go fucking vote liberal is a big deal for me. So since I'm making the big deal out of it, please go do it. And I am encouraging anybody that owns a business of any kind, and especially those that own pop businesses, to try to give people incentives to vote. One of the ideas that I've been kind of throwing around is saying to businesses, like, if you're a business, say to your customers, hey, if you come in with a selfie of you outside your voting station proving that you went to vote, don't have to prove who you voted for, because that's where the legality is, you know. If you know, get people out to vote, and then, you know, give them a free coffee, give them a free pack of papers, give them a free day pass, whatever it is. If you voted that day, promote your customers to vote. This is something that nobody has to manage. It's not about talking about whose money's going where. It's like, look, if you own a pot business, encourage your customers to vote. Encourage them to vote for legalization. I don't have to tell you what party you're encouraging them to vote for when I say that. Encourage them to vote and give them incentive. This is the most important time we've had in 90 some odd years.
That's right.
And it's kind of make it or break it time. If we can't do it in 2015, I don't know what I'm going to fucking do, people, because I've been doing this for a long time, and I'm goddamn tired.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody keeps saying, like, Well, what are you going to do when the marijuana becomes legal, Tracy? You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to retire and I'm going to take up fucking gardening. That's what I'm going to do, because I don't grow right now because I am too busy. I would like to retire and finally take up gardening.
That's cool.
You know, and I'm going to develop a strain. It's going to be a sativa.
Tracy Cush.
It's going to be a sativa. It's going to have lots of red hairs in it. It's going to be a cross of early girl, and it's going to be called Curly Girl. And
nice.
It'll, yeah. And
that's a good one.
And it'll keep you awake all night.
Yay.
Because it's a sativa, and that's exactly what I use them for. So,
okay,
you know,
Tracy, I got to take off.
All right, go get signatures.
Thank you.
Go. Thank you so much for keeping me company, because I am without a host. And
by the way, Aaron said to me that Ron Hill thing is a Skunk Presents.
Skunk Presents? Really?
That's what I said. Really?
Interesting.
And that was the second thing I said. Interesting.
I may have some perspective on...
And then the thing that Aaron replied is, you think Tracy would have known that then?
You would think Tracy would have known that.
You would think Tracy, of all people.
You would think Tracy would have known that, of all people.
Did you lose some facts with that toe?
I might have lost some street cred with that toe.
Yeah.
But it's not the first time that the skunk folks have surprised me at all. And I have a good idea of... who is behind that and how that happened, and suspect that I actually do have an inside, some inside info on that, but you will have to wait till next week so I can call Sita and get it. Because that's the connection right there. I know exactly where that connection is happening, and they've all been basically, you know, told to leave me alone for the next little while. So I'll get the skinny on that the next time we have a phone conversation. Yes, come chat.
You're on a hiatus break
I'm on a drugs are making me dumb hiatus. Yeah, so the only thing, like, I promised Chris that I would send him the script of the show, and I kept trying to write it and trying to get through it, and then I'd be like, shiny. And I'm not ADD, I'm not ADHD, I'm usually pretty good at getting things done, but I am just like Swiss freaking cheese, my brain. And like, it wasn't until the doctor actually said, like, how are you with the antibiotics? Like, you know, you have any stomach issues? And I'm not really. And he's like, well, how are you doing for like memory and like cognitive function? And I'm like, oh shit, yeah, no,
now
that's a problem.
I know why I've been
feeling
out
that's
of it.
A problem.
Yeah.
So he's like, well, you know, that'll last, but you know, it's better than some of the antibiotics they've had me on. People don't realize how being sick can be really expensive. So I've been on, I was on seven different antibiotics over a 7-week period. One of them was like $500, and I was on it for 3 days because it started to shut down my kidneys. Like, it was just like, and then I'm holding on to all of these antibiotics that they've put me on and taken me off and everything else, and all I can think of is the people in third world countries that I could probably cure with half of one of these pills, and I don't know how to dispose of them. Like, it's crazy because, like I said, they've been switching me on and off all of these drugs, so I'm not actually even finishing most of the meds.
Can't you take them back to the pharmacy?
You could take them back to the pharmacy for disposable. You can't take them back for refund. Right? So that's what I'm going to have to do, and I actually do that with, I have a Sharps container that I actually take in because I do the injections and everything every day as well. So I have a Sharps container that I bring in, so I'll bring the antibiotics in. But it just saddens me that I'm looking at these, like, half empty, like even when I change over my IV bags, you know, there's probably about, you know, a good inch of liquid still left in the bottom of each of the bags. And then I'm thinking, I'm like, okay, there are people in third world countries that are dying of really simple infections that, you know, this would probably cure like a bunch of the, it's sad,
it's
right?
It's hard to say, yeah.
It's just, well, but, and then there's also the fear too, is because like the World Health Organization has just put out this thing about the overuse of antibiotics and how when the superbug comes, people were not going to be ready for it. I'm a fucking dead woman. Like, I have all these, like, nurses are coming in every day. I have all this health care. It's all kinds of crazy. And, like, I'm with the, like, all right, so if anybody has watched the TV show House, I can't watch House these days because I started, you know, I'm watching Netflix, whatever else. I start watching House. Motherfucker, they do a lot of amputations on that show. I didn't realize how many they did until I was like, oh my God, they're cutting off another body part. And I'm just like, I can't watch this. But the whole, if you ever watch it, I'm dealing with the house people at the hospital. I'm dealing with the, like, the diagnostic infectious disease people. And the nurses don't, they're like, oh, I've never heard of that antibiotic. And I'm like, oh, shit. You know, like, it's like, wait, I'm on one you don't know? How is that possible?
Wow.
But, you know, it's an adventure. I'm learning. I think of these as learning experiences. That's the only thing I can do. Because there's always, you know, I walk into a hospital, and there's parts of it that suck. Usually when I walk in, especially with the diabetes, it's like, for my whole life, I'm usually one of the youngest people there. And now I do to kids what used to annoy me. If there's somebody in there younger than me, I kind of get upset about it. Like, I started going to diabetic clinic when I was 6 years old, and I have all these old people looking at me going like, oh, that poor kid. And now
I knew a couple of people growing up in school that.
And it's not that big of a deal. And I've been really lucky. Like, I've been doing this for 35 years, and this sucks, but I have friends with much worse conditions with, you know, that have had to have chunks of, like, feet of their intestines pulled out and operated on.
I know people,
like,
as well. And
there are people that are worse off than me. And so I, you know, like anything, you try to remember that and kind of go on. And it's, anybody that knows me, this is the most difficult part of all of this has been I've had to sit down and not do anything. And I don't know how to do that. And the fact that I do a lot of stuff that I do is brain work. I do a lot of data entry. I do a lot of stuff and planning for other events that I haven't been able to do either because I'm not functioning the same way. I'm making too many mistakes. The resting is like, thank God I have the quilt. Hey God, as I was going a little nuts,
it's
I'm like, okay, I need
to
find something
to
do.
Your mind on, yeah.
Because I'm usually, like, baking something and doing laundry and, you know, writing something and. Right now it's, like, one thing at a time.
Yeah, you have to take a vacation break from it all.
Yeah. But this, you know, this one's fun because this one, like I said, it's the one that's getting me out of the house. I know the competition is fierce. For a spot on the stage at Vapor Central, so, you know, I got to make sure that, you know, I'm here holding the spot.
Yeah, you're really pulling your weight as Opus' co-host.
Yes,
that's
why
he relied on.
That's why he has to go get me an emerald toe. Damn it.
He'll come back with, like, a fancy ruby toe ring for you.
Slug. Yeah, it's like
you can put it right next to your
next to the toe, something like that. Maybe he'll come back with my biker patch. We'll see. You know, I don't know what kind of arts and crafts they do at Nasara, but
there'll be all that extra space in there.
I know. Well, I figure, you know, like, that's the spot when I have to go into nightclubs and stuff like that. You know, when they still search you, I can keep weed in my shoe now.
You can, like, build a stash compartment.
I can at least keep, like, a gram or two in there now. Like, you know, trying to find the brighter things. My dad is a math geek. My dad's an accountant. And it always horrifies him when I talk to him and I talk about other people that I work with, and I'm like, Dad, they think I'm good at math. And he cringes. And he, because both my brothers are math geeks too, and I was the English major, the communications major. So whenever they say, you know, Dad, they think I'm good at math, he gets all freaked out by it. And I get kind of freaked out by it too. But everything was starting going on with my health. My parents were pretty worried. And they were actually talking about postponing their vacation to Prince Edward Island. And I convinced them not to do it. And they actually left the day after I had the amputation done. And so they're leaving, and I know they're all worried or whatever. So the first thing I did was I sent a text to my mother, because I knew my dad would be driving. And I just sent her a text message. I'm like, oh, shit. Ask Dad what I'm supposed to do if I have to fucking count to 20. Because I knew that he'd be driving. He'd be all serious. My mom would be like, it's a text from Tracy. And then she'd snort. And then he'd be like, what? And he'd be like, what'd she do if she have to count to 20? And I knew that once I made the joke that they would be okay and they would be fine on their vacation. But
yeah, it's hard. I can't for parents, I guess, even.
Yeah, I don't know, and I get it, too. Like, I sit there, and I'm like, you know, my mom was all worried. I was like, yeah, but I'm like, I'm 41 years old. There are lots of 41-year-old women that have all kinds of surgeries without their mamas. I'm okay. You know, it's like, I appreciate it, and I love my mother. I love my mother to the ends of the earth. She is the coolest woman alive, and she is my hero. But sometimes she is not the most awesome of nursemaids as anybody who has been taken care of by their mother sometimes will know. Like, sometimes your mom is awesome, and then there's that moment when she's your mom.
Sure.
You know?
Family.
Yeah, where you're just like, I don't feel good. Leave me alone. You don't bring it up. Like, your parents are trying to help. My mom likes to keep me tough. And sometimes it's like, no.
Yeah.
You know, I don't want to be tough now, Mom. So I appreciate her support. I am very glad she's on vacation. You know, I get to torture my younger brother a little bit on Wednesday. I'm going to make him take me grocery shopping and make him take me out for East Coast Donairs. Because, well, you know, he's driving, and I'm using it as a limo service as long as I can. Because that's what little brothers are for.
Yeah, that's nice. That's a requirement, I think, for siblings when someone's in in a time of need.
So, okay. So, question. Champs Expo. Do you know if any of the folks here are from the Youngsterdam family, or are they doing booths this year?
We didn't do a booth last time at the TY Expo, so I can't think that we would do one this year.
And what do you know of this boat cruise? Do you know, is it an evening, a daytime?
An evening boat cruise. There's two boat cruises, to clarify for everyone that doesn't know. There are two boat cruises you can go on this month. One is the Weekend of Champs that's put on by
Presents.
The Skunk Presents.
Yeah.
Ron Hill.
And Ron Hill's boat cruise.
It's not a cannabis cup of any kind.
No, that's, I wouldn't think so. I think
that one is $45.
Yeah.
And that just gives you the boat cruise.
Yep.
And then
on the 31st is the Bong Man boat cruise.
Yeah, the 31st, Bong Man is doing his boat cruise, which is $60, and it includes all kinds of food and other things.
Yep. All right. So I have to find out. I will find out. I promise everybody I will find out more about the Skunk Boat Cruise by next week.
We'll have the tickets available here. We have, I think, like 10 or so, maybe.
Okay.
So get them while they're still here.
Yeah.
We'll have tickets for both boat cruises. So the May 24th and May 31st. They're both Saturdays coming up.
Yep. Okay.
Boat cruises around Toronto Harbor.
That's awesome.
And you can toke on the water.
Well, that's pretty awesome. And I know the party usually starts, depending on what time the Skunk Boat
the
Cruise
skunk
starts.
One, I think, is like 7 or 8 p.m. till midnight.
And then the other party that happens here usually doesn't get started till 11 o'clock or
midnight. 11 o'clock.
So I'm thinking, like,
you could
You could feasibly do both by the sounds of it.
Depends on your position, because I'll probably be here.
Yes.
getting things ready.
That's the downside of things.
Chris
kind
and I
of
were invited on this skunk boat cruise, yep. So we'll see if, I don't know if we'll be able to make it.
Well, and I understand, too. It's like, it's always the thing is everybody's like, oh, you know, do you guys have a good 420? You guys worked your asses off. It was like, you know, with GMM with me, it was like, you guys, GMM. And I'm like, I was working. I was either like, you know, putting booths up or getting banners or putting trucks down the street or. There's always something to do, right?
Yeah.
So That weekend, whenever there's a big stoner event in town, whether it's the JMM or the TY Expo, the Champs Expo, whatever else, places like Vapor Central get
all the
slammed.
Staff here know where it's like mandatory, everyone's on.
Yeah,
it's a full day.
Everybody gets slammed.
It's the busiest day of the year. It's like our New Year's holiday time.
Well, you guys opened on 420 for the first time this year, right?
It was our grand opening at 420. We had been open for a couple months, like originally at Vapor Central in the day.
But, yeah.
But 420 has always been the grand opening.
Yeah. But you guys weren't usually open in the afternoons for some points over the years. Is that
in
correct?
The beginning, it was shorter hours. Okay, it was like noon to nine or something like that.
I don't know why I thought that had continued, but I was all surprised when you guys were open this year. And I was like, they're open. Cool. Like, I don't know why I was like, maybe it's just I hadn't.
Open
I didn't
when?
Realize
what do you mean?
I guess during the day, like when 420 was going on at Dundas Square, I hadn't realized that the policy had changed over the years.
It was, you know, that happened last year was the first year that we stayed open all through the day on 420.
That's why I didn't realize.
And it is because we've now that we're paying permit fees and stuff at Yonge and Dundas Square, we're hiring security there, we're hiring the people to clean up everything.
Yeah.
So our staff aren't as much of a necessity down there at the square.
Yeah.
And there's such a demand for business on that day that we have to comply and open up our doors. But our staff are amazing. And it is one of the hardest days to work of the year.
Yep.
And that Kush.ca party coming up is another
Always the other one. Although I know that the staff, I mean, that's one of the things that, because when I was at Kindred years ago, one of the bonuses of doing those parties is that, you know, well, the leftovers have to go somewhere.
Yeah, we all have a good time. It is hard work, though.
It's killer hard work, but sometimes there are rewards at the end. But yeah, no, it's those parties, when you guys do the staff parties here, those are big nights, too.
Yeah,
and
it's
you guys do lots of work for that, even though it's supposed to be your party, too. I know that you guys put a lot
in. We usually have lots of friends through the community that will get a couple volunteers or we'll pay some people to come in and work so our staff can relax a bit more.
Yeah, exactly. No. And that's the way to do it. But, I mean, even so, though, it's like because you guys run the place, there's still stuff for you guys to do.
I'm always watching and making sure things are going smoothly.
Or somebody's like, Aaron, where is this? So it's like the same thing. I was explaining to Maddie earlier, like there have been, you know, like in Jamaica, there's certain points and times where you kind of want to change your name. Right? So it's like, you know, hey, wait a second, you know, oh, goddess, my goddess. Because you're like, Aaron, where's this? Aaron, do you know? Aaron. So, you know, you need to change your name to something fabulous.
Well, yeah, I can see what you mean, how that would work.
Yeah, because you can't get mad at people when they're like, oh, goddess, my goddess, do you know where? And, you know, they start off with that. You can't get upset.
I bet you could eventually. You still get upset at them. They're like,
well, you know, there's a couple of them that say it in kind of a whiny voice. And that gets to the point. That gets to the point. I'm looking. I don't know if there's anything else that I had on the line to discuss.
So, Freedom Party signatures are our main agenda all week long. Tracy's got her booklet. We've got some volunteers that are already out on the streets collecting signatures. Matt's one of them. We have several other people in the community that are going to be running as candidates, also collecting signatures. We have a lot of the ridings here, so if you come up front, we can look up your postal code and find out what riding you're in so you can sign the forms.
If you live in Don Valley West, please go up, see folks in the front, and help me fill out my forms because I won't be walking around much. And I am your Freedom Party.
We'll have someone collecting Tracy's for her.
Yes, because there's a fabulous team of people that are on this. And like I said,
and this is for the June 12th provincial election. I know there's the federal by-elections coming up. So June 12th, everyone in Ontario will be able to go to the polls. And in your riding, there should be a Freedom Party candidate. So
Freedom June Party. 12th, if you are in, look for your Freedom Party candidate. If you are in Don Valley West.
It's Tracy.
Look for me. Hi.
I'm running in Thornhill.
That's your town.
Yeah, a lot of the other employees and staff here are running as well.
Yeah. So, like I said, most people are worried about, most parents are worried about, peer pressure getting their children into drugs. What they need to realize is peer pressure is going to get your children into politics. It's politics. That's what happens. And this has been like here's one thing I will say about your husband. He's persistent. He's persistent.
Chris.
Every time he asks, I'm like, Chris, I do not have a history that is conducive to a political career.
That's awesome. Yeah.
And he's like, and that's why you're perfect for the Freedom Party. And I'm like, Chris, I do not have the time commitment to work with this. That's okay. We'll have people help you collect signatures. He is persistent.
Yeah.
So, yes, I have finally succumbed to peer pressure. And I will probably represent the Freedom Party in the Don
Valley. And Opus is also running on the Danforth.
He's on the Danforth. Very cool.
Chris is Toronto Center.
Okay.
We're still recruiting. We've got about 30 ridings left in Ontario. There's 107 across Ontario. Last time we ran, we got, 57
nice
candidates we ran. And this time we're in the almost 70 candidates we've got.
Oh,
so
we're getting there.
Once we get all the paperwork filed and it's all official, we're hoping to get in the hundreds.
Oh, that's awesome. And Paul McKeever is the leader of the party.
Paul McKeever is the leader of the party.
He was on our show last week. He Skyped in,
yes. He's also the filmmaker of the movie The Principal of Pot, which features Mark Emery, who founded the party in 1984.
Yeah.
It's all based out of London, Ontario, so that's where our offices are. And we have some big-name candidates in London, like Al Gretzky's running there. He's Wayne Gretzky's uncle, and he's been with the party for years now. He's a great contributor. And then we have Salim Mansour, who's also running in London. So we've got a great base out of London, and they're always on the radio and getting the Freedom Party recognition. So we're just trying to grow the party outside of London. We're filling all the Toronto ridings, and even up north, we're looking for candidates, we're recruiting people, we're getting volunteers. So if you know someone or you think you've got the time, get involved, contact Chris or I.
Yeah, you're in Northern Ontario, you're anywhere in Ontario, and want to represent the Freedom Party. Definitely get in contact, because that's close. You're close. You got still got like what 2 months to go?
Months
to go.
June 12th.
Yeah, it's a candidate a day. We can do it.
We only have till the 22nd to get all the signatures and forms, and that's the cutoff. So May 22nd is our deadline. We've got just over a week, so
it's not much time. Push.
Like every day, we're gonna be out there collecting signatures and.
So if you've got time to help,
yes, that's you've got what
a
we
week.
Need.
And hey, we're not asking for a long commitment. It's only gonna happen for a week.
And yeah, just last night, Cal Post agreed to run for the Freedom Party. So the next host that's coming up is also gonna be running.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome. That Cal Post guy.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't sure what I thought of him. I was like, kind of like, holding on, kind of like, Yeah, I listen to the way he talks, and I'm like, I don't know. Sometimes he's drunk. Sometimes he's cool. Sometimes he's kind of an ass.
Cal's
and
a
then
great
I
guy.
Realized that one of my favorite women in the world actually lets him touch her. So he can't be all that bad. Back in the day, many years ago, I used to go to comedy at Spirits on Church Street. Every Wednesday night, and hosted by an awesome woman by the name of Joanna. And apparently, they are, I did not know that until last week. Mm. And I was like, okay, well, he's got to be cool, because,
Joanna
she's cool. She's pretty awesome, and she lets her touch him, or lets him touch her. Yeah, so, or lets him touch them. Stuff. So
yes, Cal's a great guy. A lot of the comics, they come off a bit rough around the edges, but once you get to know them personally, they're all like sweethearts, and they're much more tame once they get off the stage.
Always ran my favorite comedy room, and he's pretty fucking funny. So, CK Podcast, him and Cal Post and Kate Trevor Wilson will be coming up next.
Yes.
I don't know what time they come up. It should be soon, though, I think.
Yeah, they're up at 9.
Yep, all right, cool. I never know how long it is because sometimes we finish
before
9.
We need like a big clock or something.
Yeah, we do need a big clock or like a big red light that goes, shut the fuck up, Tracy. Or, you know, something like that. Just, you know, like it's time. So, yeah, what else was I going to bring up? So I find it kind of interesting. I know that you guys are, you know, you guys run the recreational side of businesses, but I mean, you guys have a lot of medical patients that come in here as mm-hmm. well. Have you guys seen a lot of people come in with samples of product from LPs?
I wouldn't say a lot. I've seen some.
What are your thoughts been on it?
It looks all right. I haven't
seen anything that looks too swaggy.
No, I haven't seen any swaggy stuff.
Okay, that's
everything looks pretty high quality.
Okay. The other thing I'm going to bring up, too, is actually something we brought up last week, and I find it incredibly interesting that here we are a week later and we're still discussing it. There are still, like, 300 girls missing in Nigeria.
Yeah, that is insane.
And they're, like, now they're offering to trade them for prisoners or something. Like, they're using them as bargaining tools and stuff like that. And I'm amazed by this because if this were... 300.
Everyone
I don't know.
Says any if it were
if this
anywhere
were
300
else, 300 cheerleaders
crazy.
From, you know, Ivy League universities from the U.S. that were, you know, in a plane that got hijacked or were kidnapped, whatever. There would have been so much effort. There would have been so much media.
I'm not sure what you're saying. Right now, there is so much effort. Right now, we have military from every country in the world on this. It's almost like that missing plane. I'm not sure what you're insinuating.
Well, it's the amount of time that it took to get the attention.
No, it was immediate. The
government that in that country refused help initially and said
we
can handle it. So that's happened in both of these cases where major countries like the U.S. immediately said we'll offer our expertise, and those countries, I guess, thought that they could deal with it on their own terms.
Well, and
I
then
mean,
you just insinuated
and then days later they come and say we do need your assistance.
And then hold on. And then Tracy also just insinuated that they were somehow playing with them as like a something to trade. When in fact that the terrorists were the ones that said we're only going to give these girls back if you can release the.
I think that's what Tracy meant.
That's what I mean.
She's saying that the terrorists are now willing to trade them for prisoners.
For prisoners.
But we've already denied that. We've already said screw. Go
yeah,
fuck
but
yourself.
But that's what I'm saying though. Is that? But that's what the Boko Haram wants to do. And I mean, but that's part of it too. Is I mean, I understand why the country would say no. Is because the radical group themselves, that their name means Western education is sinful. So the last thing you want to do is say, hey, Westerners, can you help us? You know, it's kind of like, hey, these guys are pissed off because...
All right, final thoughts. Giving them.
Final thoughts. Thanks for tuning in, everybody. Thanks for hanging out and supporting me while I'm, you know, abandoned by Opus. He'll be back. He's getting the much-needed rest. And
he still has, we have one more week with him Skyping in, right?
We have two more weeks with him. I think he's back in like 10 days, so at least one more week with him Skyping in.
Yeah.
And I just want to say thanks, everybody, for all the support. I will check on more information on the Skunk Coasted Ron Hill boat cruise.
We'll have tickets available here by tomorrow.
Check out your tickets. Definitely find out who your representative for the Freedom Party is in your neighborhood, in your riding.
Yeah. Everybody come up to the front if you want to sign our nomination forms. It doesn't mean you support us. It just helps us get on the ballot. And just give us your postal code. We'll look up your riding and get you to sign the appropriate form.
Yep. We're not asking for your soul, just your postal code.
Thanks.
Stick around and check out the CK podcast with Cal Post and K. Trevor Wilson. And in the words of Opus, keep cultivating your freedom.
Sit down! life sucks, each minute grows. This angry body, this monstrous nose, this droopy ass, this tiny tween. No wonder I get on the air and act so mean. I wish my life were much more simple. I've got a working the size of a pinhole. I'm a tortured man. I'm a tortured man. I can't believe I am no man. I'm a tortured man. I'm a tortured man. I can't believe I am no man. I'm a tortured man.
I think so.
I'm a tortured man. I'm a tortured man. I'm a tortured man. I'm a tortured man.
Shut up, sit down.
I'm a tortured man.
Well, you're not gonna be stupid, you moron.
Just think it for a minute. Should I trade half my money for 10 times as much sex? It's an equation from hell.
Oh, that's...
It's an equation from hell.
Oh.
It's an equation from hell.
Oh, that's...
It's an equation from hell.
Oh.